expound shalom, everyone. Let's all rise and worship our Father today. spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me.
Thank you.
Yahweh.
Thank you.
love the Sabbath day. Don't you guys?
Thank you. Hallelujah, Yeshua is risen.
Let's put the words back up there. Sing that one more time.
Oh, what a Savior. Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Yeshua.
Have a relationship with Yahweh, and you just know that what He wants from us is to come with all of our grief, with all of our sorrow. I think today that I know that there's people out there that are struggling with loss of a loved one close by. I know that there's others that have people around them that are sick with some kind of a terminal illness, and you know, life is full of struggle, but this is what life is made of. But through all of that, Yahweh shines through, and sometimes it is that we need to go to that proverbial altar and just pour our heart out before Him and see what He does in our life. Because what I do know is Yahweh is one that takes hopelessness and brings hope. Yahweh is one that turns sorrow into joy in time. And we don't always know the will of Yahweh in our lives, and we don't always know the reasons why things happen. But what we do know is that Yahweh is good all the time, right? Let's give Him a shout of praise because of His goodness. All right, well, I hope you guys are prepared for a good Sabbath because we have a great service scheduled. And I know that we have some new people with us, so welcome to the assembly here. We hope you feel at home. Please feel free through the service if you'd like to get a cup of coffee. Relax, you know, just try not to spill it, but your neighbor will look at you funny if you do. So sometimes that's the way it happens, but we'll help you clean it up too. So if you want to get a cup of coffee, make yourself at home again. And why don't we go ahead and do what we normally do, and that is stand up, shake somebody's hand, tell them you're about to hear a great message from Brother Steve Deneve. You're going to learn something. You're going to go home looking better than you did when you got here.
This is home.
Times.
Testing.
Love this controlled chaos every week. It's good to see people smiling. That's what usually happens. Hey, sister, how are you today? Good. We could call this last man or last woman standing. Don't look now. Look around. People that got the gift of gab, they're still up. That's all right. I give them a hard time. It's good to say hi and see everyone. It's just good to be in a place where Yahweh has inspired us to encourage and support. So we want you to feel at home. I like the way Hector put our sanctuary here. It's like a big living room. Even comes complete with couches and chairs. But if your name's not on them, please don't sit back there. Not to mention any names. All right. You guys feeling good? You guys ready for a riveting message? Well, a couple of other announcements that we have before we get started is that the Macs are having a busy time in their life. They're hosting a winter marshmallow fun, exciting time at their home tomorrow. That's from 12 to 5. The information there's on the backboard there right behind the sound booth if you're interested in going. I think the information about what's going to be happening and directions to their house is back there. Also, there is a Bible study that they're hosting. I think it's how many weeks is it? It's a 10-week session, yeah, so if you're interested in attending their Bible study, you can check out also the information's back there on the backboard on the, I don't know what I'm trying to say, bulletin board, that's it, not the backboard, that's basketball. You guys play basketball? That's good. I digress. All right, so we have children's classes today, all children's classes. That'll be from 3 to 7 and then 8 to 12. And then there's going to be a special class for those 50 to, no, I'm just kidding, just kidding, just kidding, just kidding. We'll give those guys a moment to head out. So as they're gathering in the back, going to their classes, I always want to remind myself when it comes to a message that if you're studying into the Word of Yahweh and you're carrying on a relationship or a conversation with Yahweh, I always think that on Sabbath day, we can come to the assembly and get what I like to call confirmation from Yahweh. Sometimes it's funny how when you're really involved with Yahweh or you're really seeking something or you're more involved in the scripture or you're studying through something, that each Sabbath there's something that the speaker will give. And maybe it's way unintentional. Sometimes they have no idea what you or I are going through, but I think that Yahweh's Spirit works that way in the body and that there's a connection that's made because when you start preaching the Word, it seems like good things happening, right? There's a few scriptures that stand out that talk about, you know, pray for us so that we can open up our mouths and we can give a word that will be well received into the hearts of those who are listening to that. And I do believe that Yahweh ties us together in fellowship, no matter where we are, what we're struggling with, what we're going through, what our victories are. I believe that He works in speakers to bring about messages that we can use and be verified that Yahweh is on our side and He's guiding our lives. And that's really, really awesome. Really love that part. So today, I'm sure we're going to get a great message by Brother Steve Deneve. Come on up, brother. Let's give him a warm welcome. If you have a Bible, preferable a paper Bible? Use that. Just because you can make notes and you can keep it for a long time, and in 20 years you'll thank me for that. All right? I know his man's Bible is all marked up. So, Brother Steve, it's all you, brother.
All right. Thanks, Tony. Oh, I'm standing.
Okay.
Gotta stand and be strong, courageous. And not strong enough to move this. Shabbat Shalom, everybody. Yahweh works in mysterious ways, I tell you. Man. We had a really interesting, it was a really in-depth Bible study. That's almost too high. This morning, and it was really good. This Torah portion, I don't know if you guys are familiar with this Torah portion. It's Vayeshev, and it means, and he settled. There we go. All right. So, and he settled. And he settled. Just let that settle in. Let that settle in. You have Jacob and Abraham. He was called by Yahweh to be a sojourner, right? He was called to be a stranger. He was called to be a stranger to this earth and the world system. But this Torah portion starts off with, and he settled. So before we really get rolling, let's pray. Father Yahweh, we come before your throne and we just thank you and praise you for your moeds. We praise you for your Sabbath day. And we praise you for giving us your message of salvation through Yeshua HaMashiach, Father Yahweh, through your Holy Son, Father, carrying that message from the high heavens down to this earth, Father Yahweh. And we just thank you and praise you. And I ask that you would help me speak your words this day, and that I'd be able to speak it concisely and so that it's easily understood. And Father Yahweh, we love you and we thank you and we praise you. Hallelujah and amen. So, this idea of settling in, is that what Yahweh wants for us? I would have to say, through the testimony of the whole book of the Bible, that he's calling us to something more. He's calling us to be sojourners, to be aliens in this world. And there's a specific aspect of this where we have this Torah portion primarily is about Joseph. Okay? And so Joseph is a dreamer. And when his dad decided to settle, he decided to settle down. Okay. Yeah, that's all right. He decided to settle down. And the thing is, in our lives, we find that we start getting comfortable. We start settling in, you know, to the world. There's specific things in our life that you know, we just decide, you know, I know Yahweh might want me to get rid of that, but, you know, I'm just going to keep it around a little while longer. You know, I really like this. I really like that. I really like this kind of music. I really like watching these kind of movies. And it's about our hunger. It's about the desires that are there in our hearts that determine whether we're settling or we're being a sojourner. A sojourner says, he asks a specific question. And in this Torah portion, there's a specific question that Joseph is presented with by an angel, okay? And in Hebrews 13:2, it talks about sometimes, every once in a while, you might be running into an angel. You might be entertaining an angel. So you need to be walking by faith all the time and be looking to help people when you have the chance. Anyways, Joseph was sent on a mission by his father, who has decided to settle. He's decided to make a home on this earth, and he's sent on a mission, and that mission is to find his brothers, all right? Find out what's going on with them. And so he's out there in the way it's written in my word, in the Hamash here, it says he was blundering around in the fields. So he was struggling. He was struggling trying to track down his brothers. He knew they had been keeping the sheep in Shechem, and he didn't know where they went from there. So you have Joseph blundering around, and this angel. And in the historical account, the Midrash, it identifies this angel as Gabriel, because Gabriel always shows up when there's a message specifically for Israel. Okay? Gabriel shows up, as we well know, when Mary gets the message that she's going to bear the child of Messiah. So this question that he poses to Joseph is a question that is super important. And in fact, it's the question that kept Joseph going, because Joseph, he had a rough go of it. And this question was, what do you seek? What do you seek? And this is, I mean, and he poses it in such a way that he's saying it to him so that he would ask this question of himself. Well, what do I seek? You know? And his answer was, I'm seeking my brothers. You know? And, but my question then is, what do we seek? It's the same. It's, what do we seek? And my answer to that was, it wasn't, I'm looking for my brothers, but indirectly, a little kind of is. It's, I want to do Yahweh's will. What do you seek? Well, I want to do Yahweh's will. And as a kid growing up, that was something I struggled with like crazy. It was like, you know, when you're getting ready to go to college and you literally think, I got to figure this whole thing out. I got to know what I'm going to do for the rest of my life. I got to have it all nailed down, you know? And I struggled and struggled with that. What am I going to do? You know, and I had felt early on that the Father wanted me to preach the word, because in 2 Timothy 4:2, he specifically, the charge I was given was, you know, correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. And we were at church camp when I received that message, and I was just like, okay, you know, so I was heading that direction with my life. And then different things came up, and I was just like, I ended up deciding to go into criminal justice. So I thought I knew his will, but then I was just like, I understood that quite right. You know, and so I decided, you know, I think I'll go this direction. And, you know, It's really funny because even when I went through all the education of criminal justice and got my associate stuff, there was one occupation I said, you know what? You know what, Yahweh? I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to do this one specific occupation. And that was, I will never be a correctional officer. I'll never be a, you know, turning keys. I will not. You know. But you see, you don't want to say never to the Father. Because he had plans. He knew he wanted me to teach at some point in my life. You know, and I definitely, in the church, I always did that. But his will is funny how it works, because it's just like everything else in our life. It's a process, and it gradually unfolds as we live our life. And, you know, my kids are always like, man, Dad, you worked a lot of different jobs. And I did. I worked a lot of different jobs before I finally ended up being a correctional officer. You know? But that desire to do his will was still always at the forefront of my thinking, you know? And it obviously wasn't ever cut and dried. It's something that was always in a state of flux, always changing, always morphing to something new. And so... As I was searching over the years for, like, his will, and even though he had kind of already told me, and I had kind of changed the plan that he had given me, but at the same time, the Father, I believe, protected me. Because of the way everything worked out, if I would have stayed at Olivet Nazarene, and I would have ended up going into seminary there, or going, yeah, Olivet. Yeah. Amy knows all about. Anyways, first of all, I would have been in serious debt when I got out, and secondly, I would have been indoctrinated more so into a way of thinking about the gospel, and about grace, and about the Torah and everything else. And so I really see how his will, the way it ended up working out, ended up kind of protecting me and allowing my faith to grow in a totally different way. 'Cause being in an environment where, like in a prison, he taught me a whole bunch of different things that I never would have learned anywhere else. I literally learned how to listen to him in the moment. That was probably the number one biggest thing that the Father taught me. You know, being on a wing where you're telling, you know, young teenage boys, you know, from Cook County that were at least twice as tall as me most of the time, no, you can't do that. And they're like, what are you going to do, little, you know, white punk? You know, they wouldn't say it that nicely. But they, you know, it was one of those things that you had to learn. And the Father literally would tell me, like, okay, what was going on the wing? Or if, like, somebody was thinking about, you know, assaulting me or assaulting someone else. And it was really good. And that has progressed even as I've went into adult, where now I'm working with criminally insane people. And it's a little different. It's totally different than juvenile. But at the same time, he's taught me about spiritual warfare concerning that. And there's the spoken word and how it affects your environment, how just speaking it affects the environment you're in. Because, like, I work 38, and it's for the really, really criminally insane, kind of slow or working inmates. Anyways, a lot of times in 38 and on like the X house when I'm out there, it'll be hopping where the housing unit, it sounds like, it, you know, in the movies where it's like an insane asylum and you hear all the, you know, and people like kicking doors. And it's really, I mean, people think it's kind of spooky, you know. But the thing is I learned that there's a specific word that destroys darkness. And it destroys things that cause chaos in people's lives. And the funny thing is in the Jewish culture, they use it for everything. Instead of saying hi, they say shalom. And instead of saying goodbye, they say shalom. Well, guess what? That word, it means to wage war on the things that keep you from having peace. And so, literally, when I'm doing my count on one of those wings, is I'll say shalom over every room I look in, and I'm shining my light in there. I'm like shalom, and I'll say it in such a way that it's coming from my spirit. And by the time I'm done doing my rounds, the housing unit's quiet. The housing unit is still, and I got transferred out of 38, and basically I'm open again. And there was inmates that were asking about me. They were asking, where'd Deneve go? Where'd Officer Deneve go? And they were saying to him, and another officer told me about this, that ended up working there in a 5-day. And they said specifically, well, when Deneve's here, I can sleep. And they were missing me, you know, and so there's things that the Father wants to teach us, but traditionally in my mind, if I was going to be a preacher, I would have either stayed at Olivet or I would have went to Moody Bible Institute. That was my second choice, you know. But if I would have went that route, then maybe I wouldn't ended up marrying Erica, and maybe, you know, I wouldn't have ended up in the path I'm on right now of understanding the word in a deeper way than I think I could have ever learned in a seminary. So there's two specific verses in the word that one has been my favorite for a long time, and one's out of the Tanakh and the other one's out of the Brit Hadashah. And the one out of the Tanakh is Micah 6:8. Micah 6:8. And it says, he hath shown thee, O man, what is good. And what does Yahweh require of thee? Right? So what's he saying? He's saying, first of all, what I'm telling you, this is, it's good stuff. Okay? And secondly, that if Yahweh requires it of me, then isn't that his will? Isn't it what he desires of me? It's his will. It's his will for me, right? And so he says, yes, you know, man, what is good and what does Yahweh require of thee? But to do justly, right? And what does that mean? To do justly. To do justly is to do what is right in the sight of Yahweh. To do what is right in his sight. You know, so to do justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with Yahweh. And over this last month, there's always themes that are there during the course of from one Shabbat to another or from two Shabbats linked together or whatever, but there's themes that'll rise up during the course of everyday experience. And the theme that kept rising up was, what's my will? What do you seek? Is it my will? You know, what are you going to do with that? And then, you know, And it always links in with the Torah portion, whatever it is that week too. And that question of his will. And you know, people, they get all caught up in that, and I know I did, trying to figure it out. But the thing is, he tells us what it is. In very clear terms, he tells us what his will is. Okay? And Micah, he boiled it down to three basic things. And the thing is, there's a wherever you see something in the Tanakh, there's a reflection of that in the Brit. That it's almost identical as far as the message that is there. And the specific verse that the Father pointed me to, that was the mirror of Micah 6:8, is 1 Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians 5. Okay. Be joyful always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is Elohim's will for you in Messiah Yeshua. Now, at first glance, you're like, really? How's that link up with Micah? But what does Yahweh require of thee? Okay? This is the will of the Father. Okay? So he's saying, this is the will of the Father. But the thing is Paul, he comes at it from a little bit different angle and a little bit different wording. But it links very nicely. It's kind of, be joyful always. Okay? It says the joy of Yahweh is our strength, right? So if we're joyful always, how is it? I mean, we're going to be strong. And if we're strong, then what's going to happen? What's the fruit that's going to bear? Do what is just. That was the first thing Micah said. Do what is just. Do what is right in Yahweh's sight. So we're going to be strong through the joy of Yahweh and in Yahweh, which will make it so we can do what Yahweh desires. He had a conversation with a pastor the other day, and I just was like, isn't it important that we do what the word says? And he's like, well, yeah, of course it's important to do it. And I was like, isn't that part of being a Bible-believing church? You know, if you believe the Bible, doesn't that imply that you're doing the Bible? And he's like, yeah, of course, that's what it says in James. I was like, yeah, exactly. And I was like, because he was grilling me on where I was at spiritually, and he was trying to imply that I was on the wrong road. And I was like, so what you're telling me is all the stuff that you're doing that men established is more important than what I'm doing which Yahweh established. Is that what you're trying to tell me? And he's like, oh, wait, no. Yeah, he was getting all nervous. He ended up jumping up from the table and said, I got three kids, I got to go. And I wanted to say to him, I got four kids, and I want to stay and talk some more. But being hazak, being strong, is super important in our spiritual walk. If we're not strong in Yahweh, we get sidetracked. We end up going on wrong paths with our mind. We follow paths that are going to lead us down the wrong road. So that basic understanding of just being strong in Yahweh, doing what is right in Yahweh's sight, doing is always in conjunction with believing. And I know you guys know this, but I'll say it again. There, to get this basic spiritual principle, it's a spiritual principle. Now, spiritual principles are like physics, okay? Physics, and I'm going to tell you, because there's natural laws, right? Like gravity, okay? If you want to fight gravity, you're not going to win. The only way you can beat gravity is through the law of aerodynamics, right? So there's different ways you can beat gravity, but most of the time you lose if you try to fight gravity. All right? There's spiritual laws, spiritual principles. And one of them is everything we do in the physical affects the spiritual. That's the reason why Yeshua had to physically die on a cross to spiritually free us from sin and death. Okay? And the other aspect of that principle is that for everything we do, it is measured out to the same degree to us. So it's measure for measure with everything we do. So we're called by Yahweh to be behol lavava, which is to be wholehearted in our love for Yahweh. Okay? Wholehearted. All right? Well, I'm telling you, the only way you can do that, truly do that, is if you if there's a linking between these two verses in the Brit and the Tanakh of what His will is for you. What His will is for you. And His will is that you do justly, which is do what is right in His sight, and be joyful in all situations. Because in that joy of knowing Him, you're going to be strong. And you're not going to be tripped up by all the things that the world's thrown at you. So be joyful in all things. Pray continually. Now, what's the second thing in Micah 6:8? To love mercy, right? Love mercy. There, out of all the things in our society, I think the one thing that's been attacked the most in movies and everything else is this idea of mercy. It's like if somebody wrongs you, I'm never forgiving them. The inmates are always watching Maury or what's that other guy? Jared. And they'll come up with situations like, I'll never forgive. I'll never, never, never. You know, and in the movies, it's always, you know, if you're in a situation and this guy hurt you or something, you just wait. They're going to pull the trigger. They'll point the gun at him. They might pause for a second, but then they're just like, yeah, he died. Yeah, he's going to die. You know, especially if in the most popular TV show of all time, which is The Walking Dead, I mean, there's no mercy. Literally, out of all of the media has attacked this specific thing that, what is this? This is a spiritual principle as well. To love mercy. Love it. I mean, we're talking in every given situation where you have a chance to show revenge or spitefulness or show mercy, what are we supposed to choose? Dad had a situation. He's a real estate broker, and where these guys were obviously trying to rip him off, but they were adamant about, you're gonna make sure that your buyer's going to put in new windows and all this before my guys, and everybody had already signed all the documents. So it was already a done deal. And then they were demanding this. And it was one of those situations I can't say proud. I was super happy with the decision Dad made. He had had a relationship with these people for 20 years. And he specifically said to him, I'll go ahead and pay for the windows myself if it means that we can keep our relationship. I don't want us to be hostile towards one another. We've been friends for a long time, and I'm not going to let a stupid business deal mess up our relationship. And he literally paid out of his own pocket for the windows for this place. And you know, and just the attitude they were giving him, you know, it just bitey and just mean. And he turned around and just turned it all on its head, and literally it just, you could just see it in them. They just, and they couldn't believe what they were hearing, because they were geared up for a fight. And that's the thing, people, when they're trying to hurt somebody else, they're already geared up if they know that their intent is to hurt, you know. So, loving mercy. And what's it say here? It says, pray continually. Huh. What's the link there? This is the link, guys. You have Yeshua. He's been beaten, been lashed, to the point where he literally has zero flesh on his body. I mean, the cat of nine tails, I don't know if you guys know much about that, but there's nine straps. On each one of those straps is either a piece of metal that's sharp or a piece of glass. All right? And literally, they take you and they stretch you out over the top of a stump. And you're stretched out, and then they take it and they bring it around, and it hits you and then sticks. And then they jerk it off. They jerk that flesh right off your body. And they do their best to take off as much flesh as they can and get as deep as they can. Now, if they wouldn't have put that crimson cloak around him, he probably would have bled to death. I mean, he is Messiah. He probably could have made some more blood or something. I don't know. But either way, he was in rough shape. You know, and before that, lashing, they put a bag over his head and they struck him with a staff over and over and over again and said, if you're such a prophet, tell me who hit you, you know. And I think it's a good exercise to go through in your time with Yahweh, go through everything he went through at least once a month to remember all that he went through for us. But what was the last things he said? His last breath that came out of his body was a prayer. It was a prayer. It was a prayer interceding on behalf of all the people that did this to him. It was a prayer of intercession. That dovetails perfectly with loving mercy. Loving mercy. Stephen did exactly the same thing. They stoned him. They stoned him. And the last thing he said was, forgive them, for they know not what they do. To be able to, I mean, this idea is so foreign in our society and the way we've been conditioned by the media and everything else, the idea of interceding on behalf of a person who's attacking you, interceding on behalf of a person who has done your family harm, interceding on behalf of someone who has stolen from you, But how important is it? Considering in Micah and in Thessalonians, it says, this is my will for you. This is my will for you. So, and then give thanks in all circumstances. Now, in Micah 6:8, it says, and walk humbly with Yahweh. Now, Zig Ziglar likes to say, you need an attitude of gratitude. You know, instead of telling people where they can go, you tell them how to get it on. It was something like that. But it's this whole idea of truly thanking Yahweh for everything he brings into your life. The things that come from Yahweh, this is a spiritual principle I definitely want to hit on. The things Yahweh gives you bring blessings. So, and it specifically says that if a man finds a wife, he has received a wonderful blessing from Yahweh, a wonderful gift. And it says that every good, pleasing, and perfect gift comes down from the Father of heavenly lights. Okay? So you, as men, we need to understand that you will not receive blessing from anywhere else in the realm that is your sexuality and your appetites except your wife. That there is seriously no other place you're going to find blessing. Everything else is a curse. Everything else is a curse. And so to have that attitude of gratitude to Yahweh every single day for your wife is going to bring, it's going to create and produce fruit that is a blessing. And she and your wife deserves every ounce, every bit of your attraction 24/7. You should never allow your desires, your attractions to veer off away from her at all, ever. But the idea here and the principle, the law of heaven here is that the only way you're ever going to receive blessing is when you're thankful for the gifts that Yahweh has given you. To be thankful for each one of your children. Each one of them pose different challenges, but the thing is, each one of them is meant, it has been put in your life to make you grow. So the most challenging ones are actually the ones that will probably make you grow the most. So you should thank Yahweh for them even more than you do all the ones that are good all the time. That's not easy to do. Right? And my kids are like, who's he talking about now? Who's he talking about, Willis? Anyways, so, you know, but the thing is blessings come from Yahweh. They come from the gifts that he gives us. And it's when we receive those gifts in a way that we're truly thankful. Thankful. And not only is it the people and the family, but it's the circumstances he allows in our lives. James, he goes out of his way to make sure to say something that we all struggle with the most. Is, you know, when you have trials of many, you should consider them joy, you know. And that's not easy, is it? I mean, when you're in traffic and you get a flat in the middle of, you know, like when you're driving to Chicago and everybody's whizzing by you at 80 miles per hour, do you feel thankful? No. But the thing is Yahweh can use those circumstances to grow us. And My friend, Steve Morris, he actually had that happen. And I believe he entertained an angel, because out of the clear blue, this guy shows up, tells him, okay, you don't want to leave it here because you won't have any tires left in the morning. He's like, you need to put it under that light over there. And he helped him get everything lined up, and he took care of him. And he's like, I got to go here pretty soon, but once I'm gone, I'm gone. Anyways, he literally was just like, poop, gone. But he took care of him, you know. And the thing is we, if he wouldn't have had that flat, he wouldn't have experienced that whole situation, you know, where he potentially could have been entertaining an angel, like in Hebrews 13:2 says, you know. And how cool is that? So the idea of wanting to do Yahweh's will. See, Joseph, out of all the people, you know, when you think of, he is the epitome of the suffering servant, you know. And there's what is understood, and we talked about this in Bible studies, so some of you guys are going to get a double portion of this one. But you have the Hebrew sages talk about the two Messiah theory. The two Messiah theory. They understand that there's multiple chunks of scripture, but they all become a single unit when you look at them, because they're all messianic. Okay? They're all about Messiah. They know that they're all about Messiah. But this Messiah suffers. This Messiah dies. This Messiah rides into Jerusalem on a donkey. You know? What's up with that? You know? But the thing is they always want to focus not on this Messiah, which is, they refer to him as Yeshua ben Joseph. Yeshua, the son of Joseph. But specifically, that the life of Joseph is a historical prophecy. And that's the thing, like, it's understood that everything that happened in Egypt, it's considered prophecy. It's the way they designate the Torah, that falls into prophecy, okay? Because it's a pattern that's established, okay? It's a pattern that's established. And that pattern, like everything that happened in Egypt and all the plagues and everything, is a pattern that will be reenacted, and it falls right in line with a bunch of the stuff that is prophesied in Revelation. Okay? So, poor Joseph. His brothers hate him. What happened to Yeshua? People, especially the ones that were in religious hierarchy of Israel, all they could think about was, how can we get rid of this guy? Right? You know, so you have this situation where when the angel asks him, what do you seek? He says, I'm trying to find my brothers. And there's more to what he's saying there than just the obvious. He's desiring a relationship with his brothers, because it says a little bit before that literally his brothers hated him so much that they couldn't even small talk with him. They just couldn't even look at him. They were just like, can't stand this dude. Can't stand him. He's arrogant and he just wants to rule over us. And dad seems to be going along with it, and I don't like it. You know, and it's a rough gig that he's, because his dad's like, you need to go check up on your brothers, you know. And then when he does come back with a report, you know, and it wasn't good because his brothers were goofing off, it just makes things worse. And what even more so than that, you have Yahweh giving him dreams. And, you know, he's given prophetic dreams. He knows it's a prophetic dream, because it's all these sheaves and they're bowing down to him, and he knows it's his brothers and he's in the center, you know. And so he's all excited about something that he knows he received directly as a gift from Yahweh. And he knows this gift from Yahweh is going to bring blessing because he understands spiritual principles. He understands it. So he understands that principle that this is a gift from Yahweh that it was given me. And as a prophet, what's a prophet's job? A prophet's job is to give the message. And if you don't give the message, like Jonah, we know what happened with him, right? So you'll be eaten by a whale. Yeah. Anyways, he didn't want that to happen. So he told his brothers, "This I received this from Yahweh. I got to tell you." And, you know, of course, it made him think he was more arrogant and scummy than ever before. And not only that, but he was given another one. So, the one thing that kept him going, though, was this one thing that kept resonating inside of him the whole time, was the question. The question that the angel asked him is, "What do you seek? What do you seek?" And I believe that the whole time, while he was going through one thing after another, you know, he's sold as a slave. And then he ends up and he's in a place where he's moving his way up in the ranks and, you know, in Potiphar's household and everything. And next thing you know, he's got Potiphar's wife hitting on him 24/7, you know, and he's just like, "What do I do with this?" You know, and Paul quotes this whole situation when he says, "Flee from sexual immorality." Who do you think he was talking about? It was Joseph. You know, because that's the only answer sometime when you're in situations like that. And so, but it was nonstop. Bad things were happening to him. But he kept in mind, "What do I seek? What am I really seeking?" I believe that that was a gift. That prophecy he gave me is a gift. So I'm going to believe it and I'm going to walk in it. And I'm going to stay faithful to this calling that Yahweh's given me. And if I stay faithful to this calling that Yahweh's given me of wanting to do his will all the time, even in the face of injustice, being accused of rape when you did nothing except run, having a situation where he was in prison for 12 years. 12 years. And not only that, but then the guys he's in prison with, they have dreams and he interprets them, and he's hoping this guy will tell the king about him, and it says he forgot about him. You know? So all this time, it's one bad thing after another. But his desire in all of that, and by his actions, he did what he believed. He walked and did what he believed, because every single situation, he's in dungeon, he's nice to everybody, he works his way up the ranks. He's in Potiphar's house, he works his way up the ranks, because he's applying spiritual principles no matter where he's going. He believes that every single circumstance in his life is a gift from the Father of Heavenly Lights. And he walked in it believing that. And so, by doing that, guess what happened? All the blessings of heaven opened up in Yahweh's time. And he ended up being the viceroy of Pharaoh. I believe it was 80 years, which is the longest any viceroy ever was in Egypt. So there's one more thing I want to touch on, and it goes right along with wanting to do his will. And once again, there's there's the verse in the Tanakh, and then there's a reflection in the Brit Hadashah, the New Testament. So in Proverbs 8, I figured I'd have that marked. I do have it marked. I am awesome. Okay. In Proverbs 8, 13, it says, to fear Yahweh, to fear Yahweh. And when you're reading through the word over and over again, the one thing about the fear of Yahweh is we know that that's Yahweh's will for us, is to fear Yahweh. Okay? To fear Yahweh is to hate evil in all of its forms. In all of its forms. And he's really, the Father's really been hitting this hard with me. Just trying, helping me discern anything in my life that's not from him. Because identifying all the things that are gifts from him and identifying all the things that are not from him. And this understanding that his will is that we hate evil in all of its forms. And Paul, as he does, he always comes at it from a little different angle, but it's the same message. And he says, love. He doesn't start with fear, he starts with love. And he says, love must be sincere. Hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. Hold fast to what is good. And I love you guys, and that's pretty much all I got for today. So, praise Yahweh.
This song is called My Hope, and we're going to put the words up there. Again, we want to use this in our worship set, so feel free to sing along with us. If you want to stand up and sing, that's cool too. Stretch, you've been sitting a while. If you don't want to stand up, that's fine too. If you want to clap your hands, feel free. If you want to dance, you're free here, right? And we're singing about something that's really great. The hope that Yahweh gives us. It does kind of go along with the message that Steve gave us, so. Go wrong, your love stays the same. Your light will guide us through it all. I'm hanging on and I'm leaning into you.
Nothing can reach the end of all your faithfulness. Your grace is with me through every shadow, every test. I'm on nothing less than your
trust your name. I'm holding on. I'm holding on to you. You are my rock. When all around you shelter me, I'm, and I'm safe with you on solid ground. I'm hanging on and I'm leaning into you. And I don't know where you'll take me, but I know you're always good.
Yahweh's love is one of those. It don't have a job, won't pay your bills, won't buy you a home in Beverly Hills. Won't do any of those things. It won't fix your life in 5 easy steps. No, no. Ain't the law of the land or the government. So the whole world will
Come on, clap your hands.
This is the first day of the rest of your life. This is the first day of the rest of your life. 'Cause even in the dark, you can still see the light. It's gonna be alright. It's gonna be alright.
Yahweh's good, isn't he? Love will hold us together. I hope that's what's holding your family together, and I hope that's what's holding you toward him like Joseph. Father, we just praise you for this day. We give you thanks for all the good things you're doing in our life. As the congregation and we depart from our service and we have a meal together, I pray that you would be with our fellowship. We pray that you would watch over all of your people as we end our Sabbath day and head back to our homes. Keep us safe through another week. We just praise you and we magnify your name, that it would be well in our lives as we go in and we come out. We want your blessing up on us, and we give you thanks for joy. We give you thanks for all the good things that you're doing with us. And I just pray that those who need to be comforted, that you would comfort them today. Those who need a special healing, that you would heal them. And I pray that all of your people would be satisfied with who you are and what you're doing with us. And we just give you thanks in Yahshua's name. Hallelujah. Now, this is the